Email is the glue that kind of puts it all together.
100%. It's one of the reasons that, you know, hopefully people continue to listen to your podcast, because the more they can learn about it, the better prepared they're going to be.
Hey, podcast listener, you're about to discover insider tips, tricks, and secrets to making more sales and converting more prospects into customers with email marketing. For more information about the Email Marketing Podcast or the Autoresponder Guy, go to dropdeadcopy.com/podcast. Hey everybody, it's John McIntyre here, the Autoresponder Guy, and it's time for episode 19 of the Email Marketing Podcast, where we talk about the top tips, tricks, and secrets for making more sales and growing your revenue with email marketing. Now today, I'm going to be talking to David Bass, a guy with a very, very interesting history in internet marketing. See, he worked on the Stompinet launch, which was the biggest launch in history. It was about $18, $19 million from what I remember. So for David, it's basically go big or go home. So enough of the five and six figure launches. Good stuff, but that's like child's play for this guy, David. So today we're going to talk about 10 steps to doing a seven figure launch. We're going to clear up some misconceptions initially, and then we're going to talk through 10 things that you need to do to have your own seven figure launch. And contrary to what most people think, it doesn't take as much as you probably think. So this is going to be a very interesting episode, very helpful, especially if you're doing launches. This is applicable to internet marketing, to personal development, to basically every single niche that you could do a launch for. So really great stuff. Now, to get the show notes for this episode of the Email Marketing Podcast, go to dropdeadcopy.com/EP19. Now, I need a quick favor from you. It'll only take you about 2 minutes, 3 minutes. I need reviews. So if you like the show, if you're getting some value from it and you're finding it helpful and you're getting some email marketing ideas for your business, you would make my day. Seriously, you would put a huge smile on my face if you went over to iTunes and left the Email Marketing Podcast a review. There's a link to the store on dropdeadcopy.com/podcast, or you can just jump into iTunes, go to the store, hit that search box, type in the Autoresponder Guy, Drop Dead Copy, the podcast, whatever, and you'll go and find it. And yeah, you really make my day. So that's that. Now, before we get into it, I wanted to mention that surveys are so important. Now, the question is why, right? Why is it? Why are they important? What's the secret, right? Now, Jay Abraham said the secret of marketing was empathy. And that's where his kind of strategy of preeminence comes from. And that basically means understanding your market better than they understand themselves. Now, how do you understand it? Well, you ask questions. You can do in-person stuff where you talk to prospects and plus customers on Skype. You can do surveys. You can do forums. Basically, you need to get in touch with what your market wants, what they think, what they feel, what their problems are. Because that's what drives good copywriting. That's what drives good email marketing. It's not about tricks. It's not about headlines and catchy stuff. Though all those things can help, at the end of the day, you will succeed to the extent that you have empathy with your market. You will succeed to the extent that you understand what they want and what they need, and then you can put that into words for them. This is for sales copy, for email marketing, for every time you were trying to connect with someone. And that's why I'm taking my own advice. And so this week I've set up a survey for you to complete. You can go to dropdeadcopy.com/help. There are 8 questions, and I basically set it up because I want to find out how I can serve you better. Now, I can throw out stuff and see what sticks out the wall, interview different people, ask different questions. But at the end of the day, I know that I'm not able to create a badass podcast unless I find out from you, the listener, what you actually want to hear about. So I'd like to review. This will only take 2 minutes. It's 8 questions. There's no mega responses or anything. Most of it's just multiple choice. And you like to review. I mean, you put a huge smile on my face for filling it out. And it's really going to help me. It's going to help you as well, because it's going to mean that I know who to talk to. It's going to mean I know what sort of questions I should be asking my guests. Because sometimes I feel like I'm shooting in the dark, and I like to kind of clear the air a little bit and find out, what's really going to make you get incredible value out of the Email Marketing Podcast. So once again, that's dropdeadcopy.com/help. Now, anyway, enough of that. I've gone on a bit long this time. Let's go hear about how to have a seven-figure launch from David Bass. It's John McIntyre here, the Autoresponder Guy. I'm here with David Bass, a guy with a very interesting history in internet marketing. He started his internet marketing career by working on the team responsible for the original Stompinet launch. And that launch is widely reported as the largest product launch in the history of the internet. And these days, David creates high-profile online product launches and promotions in the business, health, and personal development niches. So today, we're going to be talking about launches and some common misconceptions and what it really takes to have a six or a seven-figure launch.
David, how are you going today?
I am doing great. Thank you.
Cool.
Appreciate having me.
Yeah, man. Thanks for coming. Now, let's get started. Tell us a bit about, who's David Bass?
David Bass is a guy that started off in the corporate space. I worked for Big Five, now Final Four consulting firms. I did computer security. I was a very kind of formal, corporate consultant. And then about 8 years ago, as you mentioned, I ended up through a strange set of circumstances working on the StomperNet launch. And that's really when I had to make a decision if I was going to stay in this computer security world or switch over to this online marketing world and make a go of it. And I've been doing it ever since.
Fantastic. Okay. So launches. Okay, let's start off then. Let's talk about the common misconceptions with product launches. Some of the stuff that people think that they need, but they don't really need.
So I guess there's two things that I've seen that people kind of use as excuses almost for why they weren't able to do a large 6 or 7 figure launch.
Okay.
One of them is the niche that they're in. So they'll say, it's not possible in the personal niche. It's not possible in the health niche. I've done 7 7-figure launches over the last about 8 years. I've done it in online marketing, obviously, but I've also done it in the health niche. I've done it twice in the health niche. I've done it in personal development. I've done it in online marketing. So I've also done it in the law of attraction niche, which is kind of personal development, kind of a subset. So I've seen and been a part of launches in a number of niches. So anyone that says, you can only do it if you're involved in internet marketing, I would just, as empirical evidence and examples, say that you can absolutely do it in other niches.
Okay.
The other thing is that people think that the only way to do a gigantic launch is with a ton of large affiliates. I would say that in order to do a 7-figure launch, you need at least 3 to 4 partners that can bring in 6 figures on their own. So if you don't have at least 3 or 4 partners that can bring in 6 figures, your chances of doing a 7-figure launch is very, very slim. But it pretty much takes 3 or 4 super affiliates and then a number of medium to smaller affiliates. But nowadays you can do other stuff to really add points to your bottom line. You can do retargeting, which is a great way of kind of bringing people back, getting people to attend a webinar. And retargeting is this idea of putting a piece of code on your either website and your email. And then based on someone hitting your website or opening up an email, you can actually advertise to them on the internet. So to the person, you feel like this gigantic company because everywhere they go, you're advertising. But in reality, you're only advertising to people that, visited your site or opened your email.
Right.
But doing things like that can really add points to your bottom line. You can do viral activities with contests, with social media. So you can definitely leverage kind of your existing, partner traffic in order to, add 5, 10, 20, 30, percentage points to your bottom line. So you do need a number of large affiliates, but you don't necessarily need, 10, 15, 20 gigantic super affiliates in order to get it done. So, that's kind of, to me, the measuring stick, 3 to 4 super affiliates, and then anywhere from, 10, 15, 20 kind of small to medium affiliates is really what you need.
Okay, cool. So basically what we're trying to lay down here is that doing a 6 or 7 figure launch isn't as hard as people think, and it doesn't require what most people think it requires. And so what we're going to try and help people get out of this episode is that, if they want to do a 6 or 7 figure launch, they can do it if they just know the right things to do. So let's talk about that. What does it take to do a 6 or 7 figure launch?
Sure. I wouldn't say it's not hard. I would say that there are a lot of activities, and unfortunately there's products out there that do kind of make it almost seem simpler and easier than it is. And I just want to mention that because there's, kind of these launch products that give you a bunch of strategies and tactics. Unfortunately, they don't give you necessarily a bunch of good kind of, I don't know if measuring sticks is the right way, but they don't give you a lot of instruction on which tactics and which strategies to use when. They leave out a lot of the execution pieces. So people, kind of read or go through these launch products, learn some basic kind of strategy, and then can't figure out why, the launch kind of bombs or doesn't do what they're expecting.
Yep.
And that's, it's not necessarily extremely hard, but there are a number of pieces that if you don't kind of take care of, the likelihood for success starts, you know, kind of going down and down. So I kind of thought about what it took on each of the launches that I've been a part of that have really hit the seven-figure number and other ones that have hit kind of this high six-figure number. And I came up with 10 kind of pieces. And this isn't exhaustive, but this is definitely a good starting point that without these pieces, you're definitely going upstream without a paddle.
Okay.
So the first one, and this is one that I believe gets left out a lot, Bort.
Yep.
I had this weird kind of correlation, and there's a difference between correlation and causation. Causation means it's actually the reason for cause. Correlation just means that it's ironically, you know, kind of happens at the same time. So it's not causing it, but it's just something that happens at the same time as something else.
Right.
And what it seems is that, again, I don't think this is the cause, but it does. I've seen this number of times where a launch will kind of max out revenue wise at what the support can handle and where they start getting to come with kind of a breaking point. So every time I've seen launches not hit certain numbers, ironically, the support was maxed out at the numbers we did hit. And it's almost like if numbers had been higher, we would have been, you know, kind of screwed because our support would not have been able to handle it.
Okay.
So really, you know, and every time I've seen support being robust, being prepared, having a number of people, you know, having kind of what's called not overload, but where, you know, there's if you have too much work, there's at least an extra person that can come in and help. All that kind of robustness, every time I've seen it, again, launches seem to hit this larger number. So it seems to max out at where support can handle.
So this is when someone comes, like when the launch is happening and people are emailing in asking questions, or they buy the product and they're asking questions about the product. That's what you mean.
How do I access the product? How do I get a refund? You know, having a process for trying to save a refund, give them an extra, you know, bonus, you know, give them some extra time on the guarantee. But having people that are trained to handle all the different questions and or technical issues that can come in is often overlooked and can be a make or break situation.
Okay.
So making sure you have enough kind of personnel on the support side to handle what you're targeting is really important. You know, if you can't afford to have a little extra support, then that's a problem to begin with. You know what I mean? Like don't target a seven-figure launch if you can't afford to have 7 figures worth of revenue support in place to, you know, back it up. So it's, you know, it's really important that that's a piece that's not overlooked. The second piece, and this is kind of almost an assumption, but unfortunately I've seen enough situations where it's not the truth that I wanted to put it in here, which is a principle with personality and with credibility. So that means that you're dealing with someone that knows how to speak, you know, has inflection in their voice, has energy. They know what they're talking about. They have testimonials. They have case studies. They're actually doing what they're teaching, for God friggin' sakes. Too many of those examples where I work with principals that aren't doing what they teach, and it's just a nightmare. So really, you know, making sure what you're teaching is something that you're an expert in and you're, you know, qualified to be that teacher and to be that kind of face. And if you're not willing to do it, you're not willing to talk to people, you're not willing to be excited about your product, then find someone else that will, because you're going to have serious problems trying to sell a situation where you don't have a strong personality in front of it.
Yep.
So that's number two, a principle of personality with credibility. Number three is an out of this world case studies. So having examples of people that have had success. Now, I'm throwing a caveat in here that if you're in America, make sure you're very keenly aware of the FTC regulations and guidance when it comes to disclaimers. It's not what it used to be. Before, you could just say, you know, results not typical. Now you have to say why the results are not typical. So, you know, someone lost 20 pounds, but they also are on a strict diet plan and a personal training in addition to your diet pills, you need to say that they had, you know, strict diet plan and personal training in addition to the diet pills. But having said that, you know, make sure, and this is another little tip, if you're in America, make sure you get an advertising attorney, not just a regular attorney who's going to look up the FTC regulations and make an assessment. On two separate occasions, my business partner and I have forced attorneys to go back and review stuff they already reviewed. And sure enough, the second time they're like, oh, look at all these violations. Because we're like, hey, isn't this a problem? Hey, isn't this a problem? And he's like, oh, yeah, this is a problem. So you really want someone that specializes in the case law, that knows kind of what's coming out of the courts. Don't rely on kind of your standard attorney, because, you know, you can't go to court and say, but I got an attorney to review it. The court's going to say, well, you got the wrong attorney. So it's really, you know, if you're in America and if you're at all trying to get any size to your situation, knowing the laws can easily prevent you from getting serious fines. I think they're up to $16,000 per instance. So if you sent an email out to a 10,000 person list and you put a case study in there that violated the rules, they could fine you $16,000 times 10,000. So you definitely want to at least understand the rules before you go for kind of
like
a big
the wise thing to do.
Yeah, it's just, you know, the whole cover your butt situation.
Okay.
All right. Number four, you need someone on board with a holistic view, someone that actually understands what a launch needs to look like, understands what is the hook at each point, what's driving them, from point A to point, you know, sale. If it's not, unfortunately, as easy as just creating three kind of content videos and then, you know, a short sales video, and then you can watch millions of dollars pour in. There's a lot more to a progression that kind of hooks people in, that brings them to the next place, and then eventually gets them to buy the product.
Okay.
It all has to be tied in. And if you don't have someone on the team that has either been through it or really understands what it takes to get someone, you know, from interest to engagement to sale, then you're going to be wondering at the end why it didn't work, unfortunately. So that's an important piece, having at least someone on board that's done it before.
Okay.
You need a solid technical team for sure, or person. Going into a launch with kind of half, part of my language, half-assed tech people is going to get you in deep crap. You know, I've seen things from, you know, merchant accounts have problems, gateways have problems, sales page have problems, order page have problems. You know, making sure A, that your partners get tracked, that money comes in, and that you know who to pay at the end when it comes to your partners.
Yep.
Is all stuff that seems like it should just be easy and work. Unfortunately, I've seen enough situations where it wasn't thought through enough. And, you know, in the end, there were, you know, mini to major nightmares that came out of it based on not having the right technical situation in place.
This is a pretty standard thing with launches, right? Every time I hear someone who does a launch, there's always last minute screw ups where just shit breaks down.
Here's a classic phrase. I wish I had another month. I wish we had planned another month. I wish we had another month. I'm not kidding. I've heard that 15 times over the last 7 or 8 years. I wish we had spent another month testing, or, you know, making sure this stuff is working, or going through, you know, at least going through the process ourselves, you know, whatever it is. It's just, you know, if you're planning for a launch, there's a good chance you're at least a month too short in your planning.
Right.
And you really need that extra month for testing, make sure, you know, that things are doing what they're supposed to, and that you feel really confident, because it's really especially if it's your first time going out, you know, first impressions are huge. And if partners see that you're doing stuff in an unprofessional way, you know, things go wrong that shouldn't, if you were tested and really, you know, had your ducks in a row, it just makes it really hard to ever get them to support you again.
Yep.
So making sure you do it right the first time, even if it's, you know, cost a little money or time, could be the difference between one, having success, and, you know, two, having, you know, long-term stability versus, you know, sitting there wondering, you know, how it didn't work and why, you know, why it all fell down at the end. All right. So that's number five.
Cool.
Number six, you need solid and congruent affiliate partner traffic. Meaning, if you're a personal development product provider and your partners are all internet marketing and you're sitting there scratching your head wondering why your conversions are so bad, it's probably because you have the wrong audience that you're going out to. So making sure that you're going to the right partners, the right traffic is really critical because one, it'll make you the most money. And two, it will let you know what is reality, you know, if you're actually creating a funnel that works or if you need, you know, to work on it. But if you're going to the wrong audience, you know, you'll never know what reality is because it'll, you know, never do what it's supposed to. And you'll sit there and you'll change things and you'll, you know, modify things and you'll be like, why isn't this working? And the answer is because you have the wrong people mailing for you.
Right.
So making sure that the audience is congruent with what your, you know, message is really, really important. Number seven, solid marketing artifacts. This is everything from, you know, and when it comes to videos and webinars, they don't necessarily have to be super fancy, but, you know, clean, professional, you know, going through them enough times that you catch anything that's obvious that people will look at you kind of in a weird way based on not having, you know, fixed or edited out, you know, all those different kind of things that are the difference between looking professional and mature and kind of looking like you're this, you know, small kind of company, just, you know, half-assing your way through it. Yep. Is really kind of important. And a lot of times it doesn't necessarily take much to clean things up, but not doing it is the difference between, you know, success and you know, medium to major failure.
Okay, so it really pays off when you're doing the videos, have like a nice little intro, you know, make sure the sound's edited properly and all the audio matches up with, you know, the mouth as it moves. Well, basic stuff, but it helps.
But, yeah, and it's important. It's all these little things that people kind of leave out when it comes to, you know, explaining what's important in these launch situations. And unfortunately, it's things that I've had to fix over and over and over again, where a lot of times it wasn't even my responsibility to fix them. But, you know, I'm not the kind of person that's going to, you know, notice something, identify something, and then not do my best to make it better.
Right.
So that's really important, you know, just being professional about how you approach things, make things are edited, making things are clean, making sure you go to, you know, at least medium level, you know, kind of providers, be it editors, be it videographers, but making sure that, you know, your stuff looks good and that you would actually see a professional business offering this is important. So number eight is a top-notch affiliate manager. And there's two roles that unfortunately people will merge together. And most often it's best as two separate roles. So one role is affiliate broker. A second role is affiliate manager. The affiliate broker is one that actually goes out, solicits partners, sends emails, makes phone calls, does their best to do that kind of icebreaking and getting people in. The affiliate manager is the one that sends communications to all the affiliates in a broadcast, that handles the back end, that makes sure all the sample emails are in place, that helps decide, you know, the affiliate contest, helps decide the schedule of mailings, all pieces that really are required to enable the affiliates to be successful versus getting them on board to begin with. You know, so, you know, you'll either get not enough affiliate brokering and the person will spend too much time kind of managing the partners that are on board, or the person will spend too much time kind of reaching out and trying to get people engaged. And then the actual, you know, handling of the affiliates isn't done properly. Both those are key roles. And if you try to merge them, you know, it's often going to be, you know, not as robust of a situation as you can otherwise have. I mean, if you're in a smaller situation, you can only afford to have one person, you know, do both. It is what it is. But if you're trying to build a bigger situation, separating those two roles out is going to get you the best bang for your buck.
Okay.
You know, even if it costs extra money.
Okay, that makes sense.
All right, we got two more. So number nine, and this is going to be your favorite. It's a solid email copy and progression. So email is getting harder and harder these days to quote-unquote make work without getting your email account shut down, without getting into the spam box, without getting people, you know, unsubscribing, complaining.
So really having someone that isn't just a copywriter, because I promise you a copywriter is going to screw the pooch when it comes to writing email copy. They might be great at writing newspaper copy, magazine copy, landing page copy, sales page copy. And you know what's going to happen? They're going to use that exact kind of style when it comes to email, and it's not going to get you the opens, the clicks, the agents. You're going to have, you know, they're not going to, you're not going to be able to understand why you're going to the spam box. You really need someone that understands when to use short copy and when to use long copy. You know, anyone that says you should always use short copy, I 100% disagree with. Anyone that says you should always use long copy, I 100% disagree with. I think there's very specific times when short copy is going to get you the most bang for your buck, and there's times where longer copy is necessary in order to set up the situation where you're going. So having someone that understands when to pitch, when to send content, you know, how to balance the two in such a way that gets people moving along, but doesn't piss them off. All these different pieces are things that I've seen take for granted over and over again. And when you have someone that knows what they're doing, you can, you know, have $1 million coming. You don't have someone who knows what they're doing. Yep. You can be $10,000 and they're scratching their head, wondering why people aren't opening the email, holding on the links. You know, even when it comes to split testing emails, all those different aspects of getting, you know, results from email. If you don't have someone on board that really gets it, has done it before, has seen and gotten results before, you're going to, again, be swimming up this proverbial hill, swimming up, what's the expression? Going up the proverbial stream without a paddle.
Something like that.
Something like that. It's been a long day. So that concept of, you know, what you really present, what I think you focus on, of understanding how to create emails, autoresponders, you know, recognizing what spam filters are.
Right.
You know, knowing all the best practices, all that stuff. If you don't have someone on board, good luck, you know, getting any kind of real results, because you're not.
So email is like a central part to any kind of launch, that you have to get this piece right, is what you're trying to say, right?
It's at least 90% of your results are either from email or are because of email.
Yep.
Right. Like, you know, getting them to a sales video, getting them to content pages, getting them to a webinar, getting them to a webcast, getting them, you know, a scarcity message, which we'll talk about in a second. All this stuff, which makes the launch work, is 90% from email. I mean, you might have some, you know, SMS stuff going on for reminders on webinars. You might have some retargeting going on the internet. So those are pieces that you can do to, you know, add icing to the cake,
right?
But make no mistake, your cake is foundationally built on email, and without it, you're, you know, let's put it this way. In the IM space, every 10,000 leads on a strong launch ends up being about $1 million. So I've seen a 27,000 person list be a $2.7 million launch. I've seen a 36,000 person list be around a $3.6 million launch.
Yeah.
I've seen a 15,000 person list be a $1.7 million dollar launch. I've also, in the personal development space, seen it be about every 10,000 leads is $100,000. So it's taken, you know, 100,000 leads to get to seven figures in the personal development space. But all of it is based on, you know, kind of revenue per, you know, email situation. And it's all based on how many emails you can communicate with.
Right.
I mean, I've been at launches where Infusionsoft has not liked newer emails. So they've kind of delayed sending out to them and then not been happy with initial results and therefore stopped sending. So, you know, instead of being able to send to, say, 30,000, you can only send to 24,000. That 6,000 in the IM space, again, it's $600,000,
yeah.
You know, right? Knowing, you know, how to move those to a different place and get access to them is a big deal. And having someone on board that, again, understands what they're looking at and knows what they're doing is critical. So that's number nine, making sure you really have someone that knows what, you know, Mr. John McIntyre teaches about autoresponders.
Yep.
And then number 10, and again, this is not all inclusive, you know, there's different roles that need to be done, but these are kind of fundamental, foundational pieces that I've often seen, you know, not done either, you know, completely, fully, or to the degree that they should.
Yeah.
So number 10 is a solid reason why the ending scarcity or for the ending scarcity phase of promotion. So knowing what it is that's causing a product to go off the market, bonuses to go away, knowing the timeline for that, knowing if you're going to do a reopening, knowing how that's going to look, all these different pieces when it comes to scarcity. I like what I call creating what I call a scarcity stack, which is looking for as many different types of scarcity. And when I say types of scarcity, time scarcity, that would be, you know, doors are closing midnight on Sunday.
Right.
Numeric scarcity, you know, we only have 100 products left, you know, get it before it runs out.
Yep.
Bonus scarcity, you know, if you don't act, you know, quickly, the bonuses are going to go away.
Okay.
You know, being able to use real-time events. You know, there's, you know, it's Easter this weekend, so therefore we have to close the doors on Friday so I can let my team go. So, you know, you have to action before Easter. But the key is looking for all these, you know, as many different types of scarcity, you know, and adding them up. So the best thing would be, you know, hey, right after Easter, this live, you know, these live classes start. We only have, you know, 100 slots that are available. You have to take action before Friday because the holiday's starting, and you know we're also taking away all the incredible bonuses. You know when Easter hits. You know, this is a special before Easter, you know, bonus and package that you have to take advantage of. But adding as many pieces or different types of scarcity onto each other will absolutely get you anywhere from on the low level 25-30%. On the more realistic level, when done right, 40, 50, 60 plus percent of your overall revenue in the last 12 to 24 hours. So I've seen promotions go from 600,000 going into the last day that ended up at 1.3 million.
Wow.
Right. We thought it was going to be under a seven figure launch. We were all pissed. And sure enough, the scarcity worked and bam, you know, 60% of the revenue came in the last, you know, 12, 24 hours. I mean, over and over again, I've seen that kind of situation, but what causes that is not just one type of scarcity, and it's got to be real. Can't be fake. You say it's only 100 units when there's, you know, you can make as many as possible. One, it's an FTC violation. It's called false scarcity. And then two, people will sense it. They really will. I've seen scarcity attempts that ended up being a little speed bump in extra revenue. People just did not believe that the doors were actually closing, you know, that weekend.
Yep.
They knew that, you know, the program wasn't starting for 2 weeks. So they just inherently felt that, you know, you were going to reopen it. So making sure you really, you know, have these good reasons why for the scarcity and you think through them is the difference. You know, again, when done right, you can add 40, 50, 60 plus percent of your revenue in the last 12, 24 hours, which means you can spend 10 days and then literally go from whatever number you're at to more than double when closing the doors properly. It's one of the reasons for doing a launch, right? It's the reason that you can sell more in a 7 to 10 day period than you can, you know, in a 7 to 10 month period.
Right.
But if you don't stack the scarcity properly, you might as well just have an evergreen ongoing situation because you're not going to get the benefits of a launch without closing it down and figuring out ways to really get people to take action.
Okay. Fantastic.
So, yeah, that's kind of the last piece of the overall, you know, equation is making sure you understand how to close it down properly and really get people to understand why they have to take action and why the value is going to disappear if they, you know, don't buy, you know, your product or your service.
Okay, cool. Yeah, that's awesome, man. So like a step-by-step 1 to 10 of like fundamentals. So just to sum it up for everyone, I'll just read them out just from 1 to 10. We got number 1, solid customer
support. Number two, a principal or a main person with personality and credibility. Number three, they need to, you need to have out of this world case studies. Number four, someone on board with a holistic view of the launch and who's kind of been there, done that. Number five is a solid tech team or someone who can, you know, make all the tech tweaks. Number six is a solid and congruent affiliate partner traffic. So it's going to be relevant traffic that's going. You can't send make money online to, you know, personal development offer. Number seven, solid marketing artifacts. Number eight, a top-notch affiliate manager. And number nine, great email copy. And email making up for about 90% of the results from the launch. And then number 10, a solid reason why for ending the scarcity, not just saying it's going to end.
Yeah, when I say 90%, keep in mind, I don't want to take away from, you know, the value of your videos, your webinar, your webcast.
Right, right, right. Email is the glue that kind of puts it all together.
100%. It's you know, one of the reasons that you know, hopefully people continue to listen to your podcast, because the more they can learn about it, the better prepared they're going to be for doing kind of ongoing, you know, both activities to their interest list, their audience, and, you know, occasionally really building up these large promotional situations. Without that understanding of email, you know, you might as well pack it up and, you know, find a different job.
Cool. All right, man. Well, I think we're around about time. To be honest, I have no idea because I haven't been counting the minutes. But before we go, give yourself a plug. Tell people, you know, where can they hear more about you? I know you do some launch consulting, and then we'll say goodbye.
Yeah. So I've been working with my business partner, Robert Grant, who's just kind of compliments me really well. He does a number of the pieces that I don't do as well, webinars, scripting, video scripting, landing page stuff. He's incredible at. So both of us have been really helping clients, both from a weekly, bi-weekly coaching in some instances, and in some instances we're really kind of going in and creating a whole entire situation for the client. So we kind of do a range from, again, just directing, guidance, and helping all the way, you know, through bringing our teams in to really, you know, do stuff for a business. So if anyone's interested in discussing, you know, any of that, you know, we offer about a half an hour strategy session where we kind of go through what your business is, what you're looking to do, what we offer, and if there's a great fit, awesome. And if not, no worries whatsoever. If anyone listening is interested in that, then you can reach me at dave@reachglobalmedia.com. That's dave@reachglobalmedia.com. And in the subject line, just put, you know, interested in strategy session or interested in coaching, and I or my assistant will get right back to you.
All right, Dave, I'll put that email address with like a special bracket so you can't get spammed in the show notes for this episode. So if anyone needs to get that, they can go to dropdeadcopy.com. Thank you again for your time, Dave. This has been great.
You're welcome. If anyone has any questions, you know, you send my email or send it over to John. I'm happy to give you feedback and answer them.
Sounds good.
Have a great night.
Hey everybody, thanks for listening. If you want to discover more insider tips, tricks, and secrets about driving sales with email marketing, sign up for daily email tips from the Autoresponder Guy. Go to dropdeadcopy.com/podcast. Sign up, confirm your email address, and I'll send you daily emails on how to improve your email marketing and make more sales via email. You'll find out why open rates don't matter and the seven-letter word that underlies all effective marketing and much more.